Welcome to this week's episode, another throwback with Jesse Hernandez. In this episode, we talked about Jesse's book, Becoming the Promise That You Were Intended to Be. It's more than just a conversation around a book and around a great guy, social media mogul, but also talks about his journey through communication, which strangely and just perfectly becomes mastered through the 12-step program, where he learns to be vulnerable and learns to really understand what his purpose and what his plan in life is. So listen in.
You want to talk right down to earth in a language that everybody here can easily understand.
Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth?
Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you.
What we got here is a failure to communicate.
Welcome to the Uncommon Communicator Podcast, where we are here to bring enlightenment to the topic of communication. Help me welcome Jesse Hernandez, my guest today. Jesse is a construction mind shifter. He's building a community of intentional leaders known as the emotional bungee jumpers. He's a consultant and author, podcast host, and I don't agree with this, aspiring social media mogul. Jesse is a social media mogul. Jesse, welcome to the program.
What's going on, James? Thank you. Yes, I am working on it. I don't have the numbers that justify my mogulness, but in Jesse land, I am a mogul. And in the future, in the rest of the omniverse, I will be that social media mogul.
You are certainly defined as a mogul in my world. If a mogul inspires other people, then you're out there doing that, certainly.
That's it.
Well, did I leave anything else out? I mean, that's from your LinkedIn, so it's your fault if I left anything out.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. So I don't know about you, James, but like crafting the profile on any of the socials or even a bio for like speaking engagements and stuff, it's a really uncomfortable thing for me to do because it feels self-serving and braggadocious, right? Now, you know, I don't mind being the peacock and getting all the attention when we're live and you got the rooster on your shirt. Like, I don't mind that, but that's different than me writing about the stuff. So in terms of, if anything that was left out, I think that covers it. There's probably stuff, but I think we're good.
Well, we're going to dive in and we're going to cover some of what you just talked about in one of your chapters, specifically the chapter on I believe it is. It's the When Is I Right? Chapter 11. We're going to dive into that one a little bit because that one sparked something within me. But let's talk about, we got you on again, second time on the show. Welcome. Right here, Jesse has written a couple of books and started live streams and all kinds of things since the last time we met. Hey, it's your baby.
My baby.
Look, you don't tabulate your own, do you? But I kind of definitely dove into the book. And I've got to say this, first, a shout out to you directly. You are responsible for, I believe, any success that I should be giving you royalties on the Uncommon Communicator podcast. We met early on, and you inspired me to podcast. We were at this lean event, which was like $5 or something to go to a Gemba walk. And you were just even a portion of it. You weren't even leading it. And you mentioned podcasts. And I'm like, hey, what's this about? I don't even think I had listened to a podcast before then. And I thought, man, if Jesse can do this, I want to do this. And I did. So you inspired me to start my own podcast. And I appreciate that. And really owe a lot of its growth to following the social media mogul that you are. But you wrote a book right here, Becoming the Promise. And it is your second first book.
Correct.
You want to explain that before we move on to this one?
Yeah. So the second first book. So I had begun writing this book, which is Becoming the Promise You're Intended to Be, I don't know, maybe 2 years ago. I was inspired by my friend Lee Crump, who wrote the foreword in the book. And as I was, so when I started writing it, I was in my head, I was like, okay, I want this to be like essentialism. Like, you've read the book Essentialism?
I don't think so.
Amazing book. Great ideas in there. And the five dysfunctions, right? Lencioni and kind of the way they write their books. There's a story and there's takeaways. And so I started writing it, and the idea was I became aware that two things I became aware of. One was I became aware of when I transitioned from achieving to contribution, my life got better. The other thing was, when this was Lee's fault, he made me aware that my story could inspire other people to forgive themselves or to forgive family members, et cetera, and give them hope. So anyways, I was writing the book. That's right about that time, Jennifer Lacey and I started having the live streams about 5S in relationships. And so after those live streams, and you were a part of those, a lot of people were part of them. Kirby Coates had asked, like, "Hey, Jess, like, I wish there was a place that I could just have like all the nuggets, all the great practices that people shared in the chat." And I said, "Okay, well, I got all the transcriptions. I'll go read them and find them." I spent about 10 minutes reading, and I said, "Hell with this! I ain't gonna read all of this." It was like 8.5 hours of content. And then I said, "Wait a minute! I've got all this transcribed." Kim White, Princess Kim, was my coach in publishing the first book. I sent her an email and said, "Hey, I got an idea." This was like December 2 years ago. And she said, "Yeah, let's do it." So we did. And so I had to pause on this book because that was the first book, work through producing Lean in Love. And then once that got out, I picked up this book again. And it was interesting because when I read my original transcript, I was like, this is garbage. This is like weak sauce, kindergarten, tough guy stuff, right? And when I mean by kindergarten, tough guy, I mean like not so, this is just superficial, top water skiing crap. And that's because through the live streams, I discovered that this vulnerability thing was a thing. And I didn't understand it at first, but people were like, "Jesse, it's because you share your mistakes and you just talk about anything, any mistake that you made, whatever I learned." I was like, "Oh," and that was valuable for people. So my mindset had shifted such that it was like that first draft was like, there was no vulnerability. It was very cerebral, super intellectualized. And so I said, "Hell with that. I'm going to go deep." And then that's what happened. So that's why it is my second first book.
So the first book then in that pause really helped you bring a better product in this book with a different set of eyes. Isn't that great how, and I'm a big believer in how, you know, things happen for a reason. And you look at that and then always to the better, if you're looking to find the better out of it, because it's always hidden in there somewhere. So let's talk about the book first, its structure. I like talking about the structure of your book. It is a bunch of stories, which are fantastic, right? And they're serving the purpose which you want, is these stories help impact and lead to the message. But there's a couple of things that I noted in here is every one of your titles are questions. Almost yeah. Every single one of them. And I thought, that is Jesse. And in it, which made the investigator in me say, where is the question in it? Because what I really enjoyed about the book, and it's almost like a mystery novel, is if, you know, if say here's a chapter start right here that says, you know, is there a prize in the darkness? You don't start the each chapter with, is there a prize in the darkness? And then answer it. It's in there somewhere, which is really kind of new. I don't know if you did that purposely, but the question is hidden in there. So I love that. You have Master Questionator as your title, and that's something that, you know, a moniker that you have given yourself. No, I mean, I've given that to you as well, yeah. But it's all the chapters are questions, which is really makes you dive into, does that question fit me? So I love the idea of it. And I did something I don't normally do, which is I read the first chapter and the last chapter, because I wanted to see how you circled this around. And so this is an interesting, so at the end of your very first chapter, you said this: "We just can't keep living life the way we've been living it. We have to let people in. There are too many of us for you and me to continue walking alone." Now that, obviously you put that for a reason. Tell me a little bit more about that purpose statement that you put in there.
Man, thank you. Thank you. So, you know, the gist of that statement is, And it's something that I discovered, right? And you can hear all the details throughout the book. But the gist of the statement is, for a very long period of time, I believed I was the only one experiencing the pains that I was experiencing. And I thought it was unique to me because of my deficiencies, because of my defects. And what I've learned over the years is that it's absolutely not unique to me. And it's not because I'm my character defects. It's because I'm human. And we're all human, right? So going back to the vulnerability thing, when I share the stuff, the dumb stuff, the short-sighted, selfish, embarrassing, shameful things that I've done, and what I've learned from them, that helps others know that they are not alone. And none of us are alone, but we're all walking. I shouldn't say all. Many of us are walking as if we are. And so it's a call out to say, hey, I got you, right? Like, we're people. We make mistakes and we can learn from them. And you know, walking the path in community is far more fulfilling than it is to be walking it independently, which ties to like the original idea of achievement and winning. Because when I win, everybody else has to lose. And when I achieve, I have to do better, score higher than everybody else around me. So that's the isolating experience. Whereas contributing, sharing my gifts and talents, that is a communal experience.
Yeah, and that's okay. So now I'm going to jump into the last chapter because I don't know. I do know you tied this all together, and so your very last statement in the book, because you know that I think about in any message that we give, the most important thing is how we start it, and the second most is how we end it. And sometimes that's the most important because that's what people remember. But this is what you said: today, I surround myself with people who appreciate the goodness. You likely have X-ray vision too. You can see the enormous, gigantic human being that is in front of you, hiding behind fear, hiding behind perfection, and avoiding rejection. Because you can see this, it is your responsibility to let them know what you see. Point it out, show them, help them understand you see them, because we all need to be seen.
Did I write that? Damn, that sounds good.
And that's how you ended it. You tied in that very first statement to the end with some fantastic stories in the middle. But tell me about that statement, because that one really, it's a challenge, but it's coming straight from your heart.
Yeah, man. First, I got to confess, I did not do that tie on purpose. I absolutely, for real. When I put the stories out, I did speech to text, and I just had a list of stories, and I shared all the stories, blah, blah, blah. Kim, Princess Kim, is the one who arranged the sequence of the stories. The only one thing I wanted was story number one had to be number one, because people needed to understand the title. The rest of it was up to her. I just left it up to her. And so I got to credit her for that. But the fact that you put it together, like, that's pretty awesome, man. So that last statement in the end comes from, and I think a lot of, I'm not alone in, rather, I know I'm not alone in this. You know, when I think of me, it kind of ties back to the bio thing. I see all of my mistakes, all of the nefarious things that I've done, selfish things that I've done, all the goals that I missed, all the people that I let down, all the disappointment that I contributed to people's lives. And I see it like a hall of mirrors, right? Which means they're magnified and amplified and contorted and really way bigger than what they actually are. And that's all that I see. And so that keeps me in this state of feeling less than. But when I interact with another human being, I'm just like you saying that I've contributed to your path as a social media mogul. I don't see that. The only time I see it and the only time I can believe it is when I'm seeing myself through your eyes. right? And so when people talk to me and share with me of how I've impacted their life, how I've given them courage, how I've given them hope, how I pissed them off, like, it doesn't matter. When people are telling me what they see, I fall in love with that version of me because it is true, but it is foreign to me because it's not the version that I see all the time. And so, like, I know how I feel when I'm around people that reflect back to me the greater things that I ignore. And so that's the idea, right? If I surround myself with people, because for a long time I doubted it, I discounted, like, no, you just don't know all my garbage, right? The only reason you're saying it is because you don't know. I finally got to a point where it's like, you know, I'm very selective about who I surround myself with. And those people are like ballers, right? Like they contribute to the community. They're not just about themselves. They have accomplished great. They're very accomplished in their careers. They're honest. They're good people. And because they are, I need to believe what they're telling me. Right? And so it's that kind of, it's a little weird thing, but it's what helps me get away from operating in a sense of deficit, right? Meaning like I'm trying to make up for something and keeps me in a place of contribution. How do I continue to share my gifts and talents? I'm not always aware of the gifts and talents. I'm not always aware of how I impact and touch people's lives until somebody tells me, mm-hmm. and they show me through their eyes of what they see. And so that's the point, right? Is find people around you that tell you things that you don't want to believe because they're not lying. And that gives us freedom, right? That gives us permission to continue being super awesome.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, the book, I mean, you dig really deep into some personal stuff. And what was, interesting, and we've known each other for a year and a half, a couple of years now, but to really understand the backstory a little bit of what brought you through to your sobriety. I mean, in a lot of sense, this is a book to help anybody out of who's into addictions, and you're specifically talking about substance and alcohol, but those type of abuses fit any type of addiction, and a lot of construction folks have them. There's a lot of alcoholism, a lot of drugs and stuff involved in any business that you're at, but specifically in our trade as well in construction is workaholism. I mean, there's things that we become addictive to. I come from an alcoholic family myself, and I never, delved into alcoholism, but do I have addictive tendencies? Yeah. Did I have over 40 bonsai trees at one point because 39 wasn't enough? Right. And then for the most part, though, my addictions have been towards, work. Like last night, I worked till 7 o'clock at night because I wanted to get that floor done. There's things that become important to us in our work, which is just as much of an addiction. So these things fit. But in diving into your stories, there's the reps you talk about. Right. And I hadn't thought about AA and that whole process talking about these things more is something that you're doing with people now, especially through the live streams. There are things that I'm realizing, like why, who am I, who have not been emotional for most of my life purposely, struggling with some things. It's because, I've never talked about these, and you're drawing these out in people now as well. But I see that you've put the reps in because I can't get through it. I can't barely talk through it, but how therapeutic was it to also put all of that stuff out there for everybody in the book?
Man, so first I want to say this in terms of addiction. People have asked me, especially when I was in rehab and recovery, like in those circles, the common question is like, what's your drug of choice? Right? Because
everybody wants to know, huh?
Right. And mine is more. I'm addicted to more of whatever. Most of the stories in here are tied to my addiction with alcohol because that's what I got arrested for. And I'm grateful that I didn't get arrested for some of the other things. But I'll tell you, I'll hit on this. And so hope maybe people can do some self-reflection. Some of the symptoms of me being going down the path of addiction to whatever it is, like you said, work, marathon running, womanizing, like all of the things, is all the rest of my life is in disarray. My weeds are 3 foot. The weeds in the yard are 3 foot higher than they ever been. None of the dishes are washed. None of the clothes are washed. Everything's a mess. The truck's a freaking mess. Like the chaos in my life, it looks the same regardless of what I am being consumed by. It's absolutely, alcoholism is a thing, right? And there's some other stuff that comes with alcoholism, but having an addictive nature and over rather neglecting the other important things for one thing is also a symptom of addiction and requires attention. So now, but back to the reps, that was the question, right? Mm-hmm. The therapeutic nature of getting this book out. So when I was in South Carolina, when I started doing the speech to text, I had a lot of road time, windshield time. I was driving back and forth. I was going to Clemson with Adam to do a thing. And anyways, I was surprised at some of the stories. I think the last four stories are the ones that moved me the most. It drew out the most emotion. I didn't expect it to happen. And as I was like speaking the stories, some of the, like I cried on most of them. And when I say cry, I mean like teary eyed, you know, choked up a little bit. But those four stories at the end, even when I recorded the audiobook, you can hear my voice cracking and me trying to maintain composure. I ugly cried when I recorded them. Mm. Right. And it was hard because I had to go back and like figure out what the hell I was saying, because the voice didn't pick it up, right? And the interesting thing, so after I did it, I'm like, okay, why am I what is going on? Because some of that stuff happened back when I was a kid.
Yeah.
And the difference was I used to cry tears of anger. I used to cry tears of pain and regret. This time, those tears were maybe tears of empathy, like, because I know what I felt back then. And that kind of feeling came up. And I also know that I have come a long, long way from that. And I also know the impact that I've been able to have in other people's lives because of that experience. And I was also excited about, oh my God, I'm putting this thing out there into the world. Imagine the impact it can have going forward. And so the tears this time were like filled with all of that, right? They're tears of hope. They're tears of healing, tears of understanding. And so in terms of therapy, it helped me really, because I don't think before then that I wasn't aware of the progress that I have made around those issues. And so what it helped me understand was like, or maybe it helped me turn really negative dark times into meaningful things that could help other people. And so I experienced a mind shift of my own in the process.
In the process. And that's the whole key, right? It's not just you get the magic pill and you don't get some way to get out of it. It's that process that I'm discovering myself very slowly in understanding that vulnerability part and a lot of that. And we're going to dive into a little bit of that. Let's jump into there's a chapter. First, I wanted to talk about the whispers.
Oh, yeah.
I like and that. I've heard you mention that term before, and I didn't know the depth of, you know, the idea of the whispers. But here's another quote from your book. I was first introduced to the whispers by Oprah, Jesse.
Yes.
Anyways, the easiest way to describe the whispers is intuition. The whispers pop up randomly, sometimes when I'm running, sometimes when I'm in the middle of a presentation. They are like little data points. They look like a comment or a question by someone else. When I'm listening to a book, something in the content I'm consuming may connect with an idea or a question I've been chewing on and make the next rightest step a little clearer. The feeling in my gut says, yes, that's the way, that's the thing, I need to get unstuck. I call them the whispers because I really can't take full credit for the clarity of the direction. It feels more like I'm being guided into discovery. And boy, that statement, that idea really connected with me because, and I've heard you mention that before, this podcast is a result of a whisper. You know, you hear something, you get an idea, and somebody says, what about that? But that whole idea, I'm not sure about the Oprah part, but tell me more. Like, this seems like the whispers have been a big part of your life. Have they always been there, or has this been something that you decided to start listening to?
Oh, man. So first, Oprah, so raised by a single mom. Right. And so when I was a kid, I had to I didn't have control over the TV, but she mentioned it. I was like, oh, yeah, that's the thing. So anyhow, I'll say the whispers have always been there. I have not always paid attention to them. and I know this because even early on as a foreman, or when I was transitioning from installer to foreman, and all of a sudden, there were deeper, greater asks of me in terms of taking responsibility and leadership, I fought against it. The whispers were telling me, do this. This is your gift. Go do something with it. And I ignored it and continued to say, no, I'm not going to be one of those suck asses. I'm an installer, blah, blah, blah. And the friction that I experienced in my life by ignoring the whispers is one of the contributors to my substance abuse, right? And to the things I did to escape from my life, which most of that was self-imposed friction. So they've always been there. When I started deciding to listen to the whispers, things have become so much easier and way, way, way more fulfilling. And the reason I have to credit the whisper, even in when I have my 60 minutes of thinking time every day and I'm journaling sometimes, there's something that comes out whoa, I got to write that down. Or I was jogging, just kind of like you said, I write it down and I can't take credit for it. Right. And I think that's an important thing because I don't know if you know, but I have a pretty healthy ego. If I credit myself for being a genius and discovering all these things and creating all these things all on my own, I know where that road takes me. Right. And so these things, these ideas, these bits of clarity that pop up help me understand or show me that's connected. That's something that I've been thinking about. Now I'm going to take the next rightest step. And so what I mean by that, so example, I was interviewed on a podcast, super awesome interview. And the line of questioning was around how do leaders connect with people in the field? And so I just kept answering the questions, right? It was a good conversation. And then after that, I started thinking wow, that's interesting, because when I was doing the in-person training, part of that was to go out and meet people in the field. And a lot of the folks that were going through the training struggled with, what am I supposed to say? what do you mean? You're a superintendent. What do you mean? What are you supposed to say? And then I was talking to Sean, and Sean Moran, we were on a call, and he's familiar with the training, the sweat equity improvement that I've transitioned into a virtual experience. And he's like, all right, Jess, how are you doing the visible leadership piece, which is where you go talk to people? And I said, I don't, that's not part of the curriculum because it's virtual, it doesn't fit. And of course he gave me, he's like, come on, Jess, you're weak. And so after I got off the call with him, and mind you, these are things that have happened, let's say a 24-month timeline, right, of all of this. He hits me with that, and I'm like, okay, I need to do something. So on the podcast the other day, they asked me a bunch of questions around this. This happened way back then. There's something there. Mm-hmm. I was listening to another podcast and they were talking about email courses, and then boom, it all came together. Right. Now, I wasn't actively trying to figure out what email course to produce. The whispers showed me what the next rightest step was. And so it's just that, right? When I'm, and it also frees me up because I'm obsessive, it frees me up when I'm stuck on something of like, okay, I'm at a point and I know I need to get the next thing, but I can't. Now I just leave. Okay, I'm just going to leave it, put it on the shelf for a little bit, because I know the whispers will show me what to do with that idea. And it may not, it may be next week, it may be next year. I just need to leave it there. That's the whispers.
Well, and the key is to respond to them, right? And you mentioned about ignoring them in the past. And mm-hmm. I think that's the whole key, is knowing when to let it lay and when you need to respond to it. Because I would say I would, on the most part, am guilty of passing over and or ignoring. Yep. And then there's times where they're so loud that you have to listen, and there's enough connection, right? And so you have to find the right time, the right place. But I just thought that was that really stuck out for me in that section of the book, because that really connected. And then it's going to connect with a lot of people, because they're going to go, oh, that's why. That's why I do that. So I appreciate you bringing in the whispers and kind of sharing a little deeper talking into that. I do want to talk briefly about chapter 5, I believe. Now, chapter 5 is what are you waiting for? Another question. But the thing that stuck out for me, there's a couple of things in here. One is, so you're preparing for potentially being incarcerated. So what Jesse do? Jesse's like, I'm going to make the best time of this. What am I going to learn and get out of this? I'm going to have all this time. I'm going to, you know, you're like the Shawshank Redemption. You're going to become a lawyer or something, right? You got it all. And you wrote this, what could I learn if I had no distractions? So you start creating a list of this potential time, which for you to sit, I got to imagine was going to be probably a prison in itself. Yeah. But you're like, how am I going to make the most out of this? But this is the thing that stuck out in that chapter. My own thinking can be a prison, and I don't have to wait for incarceration to take action. Bingo. There's so many times that we wait for that moment. And this ties into your whispers comment as well, too. You don't have to wait. Like, most people solve problems when the problem arises.
Yes.
And that's where, when I have time, especially on my job, you know, I get some free brain load. In fact, there's one particular job we were on. I had taken over, and we had just a ton of problems. It got to the point where, and then we had a really young group of field engineers and other assistant soups. I'm like, what are we going to solve today? Like, we had no problems. Like, what are we going to solve today? And that's what I got from that, is instead of waiting for that potential incarceration, you know, you're saying I can do things right now.
Yes. Yeah. So, you know, that practice of seeing, like, changing my perspective of a really bad situation, I learned that from one of my sponsors in AA. And he would, because, you know, when I'm in my addiction and doing all this stuff, everything seems to be falling apart. The world's against me. Like, it's just like you can't win no matter what. Most of it is because of my own decisions and my own actions. Right. And he would always tell me, he would say, what can you learn from this? Right. Like, I know I'm in, like, and I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, I know it sucks, but what are you learning about it? What can you learn from this? So it was always that. What can you learn from this? What can you? So anyways, this last time I was like really, really looking at 10 to 15 years in prison. It was a reality that could happen. And I know that if I get stuck in my head around how horrible it's going to be, I'm going to lose my career, I'm going to lose my licenses, I'm going to lose family, money, property. Like, if I get, those are all true. But what is also true? Or what could also be true, I could also learn a lot. And then I said, okay, what is that condition that I'm going to be in if I go to prison? Like, well, I'm not going to be distracted, right? Like, I'm not going to have my damn phone bugging the hell out of me. Okay, so focus. If I have focus time and I have this just enormous amount of time to do whatever I want with, what could I do? What have I always wanted to learn? And I wrote down a list of a whole, like, learn to write left-handed. I wouldn't do that now because I got a lot of things going on, but I've always wanted to be ambidextrous, right? And so what that helped me do, working on that list, because I didn't just do it in one sitting, it helped me change my focus. So every time the scary negative idea crept in, like, yeah, yeah, that's true. And, but what could I learn if while I'm there? Mm-hmm. And writing down that list, and this didn't happen immediately. So I wrote the list down, you know, went through the whole thing, went to, got my attorney, da, 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 da. They don't give me prison time. And I think that's actually when it came together, when they gave me my sentence, which was, you know, relatively light considering what I did. I said, you know what? I don't need to, like, I have this list. And I think I mentioned in the book, one of those was reading Moby Dick. Like, I don't have to wait to be in prison to do that. So I got Moby Dick on Audible and I listened. It was awesome. I was like, wow, now I understand why people make such a big deal about the book itself. And then it was like, well, what else on this damn list can I do? Why am I waiting? Like, I don't have to wait. And then it, the realization was, we all kind of create our own prison. Like, the prison is in our head. The circumstances or our physical environment is a whole separate thing. It's not as big or condemning as our own mind is. And so that's the gist of that idea.
Yeah, and that's absolutely huge to capture that instead of saying, all right, I spent 10 years in prison and now I'm, you know, a doctor, I'm Dr. Hernandez. Mm-hmm. You know, you didn't have to wait to do that. And I think that that connects with a lot of people because we wait for those waypoints, right? Those times when that change is going to come, when we're sitting here, are sitting here, you know, scrolling through TikTok and, you know, looking at videos thinking, you know, what could I be doing to better my life? Well, I'll do that tomorrow. But when you're in prison, you know, every day is tomorrow, I guess. I don't know. I have to come up with a better saying than that. But that's, I think, a key point in anybody's successful journey in life, which you're helping them to understand. But also, you know, there's so many threads in there that tie to your project as well too, you know, a lean, so many times I am the victim of tomorrow.
Yep.
You know, oh, we'll do that tomorrow. We'll be back tomorrow. You know, last night they were working until, you know, at 3:30, I was told we had 3 to 4 more hours left. And it's like, how about tomorrow? I'm like, no, we're going to get it done today. I want my tomorrow.
Yes.
So there's just things that you become a victim of tomorrow. And yep. It stops that. It says, what am I doing now to bring purpose? So, man, I appreciate that chapter. There's one more chapter I want to dive into. This one here, chapter 11, when is I right? Now, this one I have struggled with for most of a lot of my career, and especially when I got into general construction. A lot of people don't know that, you know, I was in industrial construction, millwright by trade. So I've worked through the trades, and, you know, now I'm the evil general contractor, you know, and people don't know that there's a history behind everybody, right? That this is not. It's like, oh, you're the contract. In fact, Felipe said that he says, you don't post anything about your life, you know, when you were in the trades. I'm like, I need to change that. But but with that, you come into general contracting, and a lot of superintendents are I, right? I did this. I built that. I've worked with a superintendent who built the IKEA in town all by himself. Big ol' IKEA. And then he also built this gigantic hotel at the Denver International Airport. And so everything that he has done, he built, right? Those are his stories. But we go and we hear that, and you really touch on it pretty deeply within when is I right? I do want to talk about this. So this is just a quote I went to first. You have to know that these are emotionally charged conversations. I credit this to the repetitions or reps. We get sharing our issues openly with strangers. This builds a high threshold of vulnerability and real human stuff. So first, you know, you're setting up this I thing, because the other part is that, you know, I'm worried that it's going to be self-centered, you know, and how I use the word I don't, right? I've used we a lot when it is me. So because I want to avoid that, but I think you opened up, there's a little bit of a key in here that you really get in talking about the delivery of that. So this chapter, I think here's a quote from you. He was extremely vulnerable, because the whole thing about this I thing talks about somebody who changed your perspective on stuff. And in addition, was this, and this was somebody who was presenting at an AA meeting. Yep. He was extremely vulnerable. He shared details that most of us spend our whole life hiding.
Yes. Yes. Oh, man. So You know, one thing I got to say, I did not intend to write a book about my recovery and my experience in addiction and AA, 12-step programs, et cetera. That's just the way it came out. So just a side note. So I'll talk about like the reps and how that connected to this speaker. You know, somebody had asked me, or a lot of people had asked me back when we were doing the 5S in relationships thing, is like, how are you so vulnerable? It's amazing how vulnerable you are. Your vulnerabilities is around, like, what in the world are y'all talking about? Then I got clear, like, oh, you share your, like, the dumb things you've done. Like, oh, okay, that's vulnerable. Then yes, I do that. And then I started asking myself, there's so many people asking me about this, and I don't know how I built that. Like, how did I develop that, that strength to be vulnerable and share whatever? And so I was thinking, and I'm like, oh, you know what it was? It was from the years and years and years that I spent in 12-step meetings. Because in those meetings, you are invited to say, hi, my name's Jesse, and I'm an addict, or I'm an alcoholic, or whatever, and talk about your issue, whether it's good or bad, doesn't matter. For the first 2 years, I would not, there was no damn way I was going to raise my hand. But I saw people demonstrating the behavior, right? Like, they were doing it. They were saying, hi, my name's whatever. This is what I experienced, you know, my wife, my girlfriend, whatever, but the judge, my whatever, like all the stuff, and even celebrating good things, until I finally did it myself. And because I was, you know, I had the privilege of going to these meetings for so many years, I got very practiced at saying, hi, my name's Jesse, I'm an alcoholic, and these are the, this is what I did today. This is the dumb thing that I did, or blah, blah, blah. And I think it was, I don't think, I know those reps of saying, hi, I'm a human being and I have problems, or hi, I'm a human being and I have something to celebrate, built the strength for me to be super, super vulnerable, you know, relatively speaking. And we don't practice that. We don't, there's very few venues where we can just say it out loud to discover that the sky's not going to fall down, right? Like, me sharing my garbage. Oh, well, at first for 2 years, I wouldn't, because I didn't want to be judged. I didn't, you know, blah, blah, blah. And then with the first time I did it, guess what happened? Nothing. Nothing. I felt better. And then I did it again. And guess what happened? I felt better. Like, oh, it's not that bad. Now, so there's that one thing, because I am talking about what I personally experienced. And very few people will challenge that or judge that, because it's my own personal experience. Now, it drives me nuts when people say, I built that. I'd be like, there ain't no damn way you built that. And I'm sure that's not what they mean. But I know what I feel when I hear them say that, right? Mm-hmm. So I was always kind of similar to what you stated. I pay close attention to me not saying I when it was a we thing. But then I went all the way over to one side of the pendulum when it's always we and never me. Mm-hmm. When I heard this gentleman speak, it was powerful, right? Like, you know, he shared his experience. But he spoke from I. He didn't say, you know, when you're in addiction, da, 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 or when you do, like, he didn't say that. He said, I, my addiction, my experience, my errors, my shortcomings, my wins, like, it was all from an I perspective. And I remember thinking, like, wow, he talked about himself in terms of I, but I wasn't disgusted by him. Right. It didn't give me license. Like, I didn't disengage like I normally do. I was like, oh, wow. Well, what was that? And it was because of the way he delivered the message. It was from a perspective of ownership. He was owning his experiences. He was owning his mistakes. And that was the difference. And so it was really important, because it transformed the way, like, from that point, I decided, okay, from now on, this is how I'm going to present. And I mentioned it in that story. Mm-hmm. You know, I used to follow the practices that they right, whatever public speaking, like all those classes. You know, make sure you let them know, give them your credibility. You want to give them your credentials before you start speaking, because people want to know why they should listen to you. I stopped that crap. Those two slides with, you know, my credentials got deleted immediately. And I just jump into it and start sharing my experience around the thing, whatever it is I'm talking about. It also helped me stop, like from that point forward, I have not done a presentation on anything that I don't have real, real experience doing. And what I mean by that is, like, if I'm going to be like teaching or facilitating some learning, and I can't apply the concept or the practice in my personal day to day, I'm not going to try to teach about it, because I can't speak from my own experience. I have to attach it to somebody else's article or white paper or whatever. And if that's the case, I have no business doing it. And so that's gotten me very, very comfortable with I. And more importantly, it becomes easy to say I in a non-self-serving manner when I only speak about things that I've lived and experienced directly. Mm-hmm.
And nobody can take that from you, right? Nobody. You are sharing that specifically from your heart. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I think really stuck out for me. And this is important for anybody, you know, diving into public speaking as well, too. So this is definitely our communication moment to talk about, right? Because you're out there, you're a public speaker, you've experienced something that through Toastmasters, they call it the icebreaker. It's the very first speech that you give. And whenever I'm coaching somebody, I'm like, this is going to be the easiest, hardest speech that you ever give.
Right, it's the easiest
because all you have to do is talk about yourself. Like, we can do that. It's hard because it's your first one. But that whole principle, you know, kind of gets lost through the course of these pathways that we have, because, you know, then we're teaching on things that we don't. And that's now has been my coaching thing, is like, what, you know, talk about the things that you know, because then you can talk endlessly about it. And people know that if you're talking about something that you don't know, then people know that. They know right away. And you know it, right? And it's hard. Yes. And it's difficult to get through, and it's not fun. You know, you probably have had the luxury of giving the same, you know, message more than once. You know, every time that you do that, you build those reps. And in my mind, it's getting better. And I'm sure for you, the message is getting better. But if anything, it's getting easier, because you're having the ability to meet the audience's needs because you're familiar with the topic. That becomes kind of the whole key to public speaking, is be familiar with the topic, and then you can go up there and have fun. So I think that just, it's so neat to see that weaved into your book, this whole public speaking, you know, huge like tip on how to be successful is wrapped up in just one little note on the I portion of chapter 11.
But yeah, I'll add, James, on that is, if maybe for aspiring public speakers, people that are just kind of getting into it, I can remember clearly when I was doing presentations on stuff that I hadn't experienced, if somebody asked me a question, the answer I gave them was hard, like it was weak sauce. and I knew it, and they knew it, right? Like, oh, he's a fraud. He just read some article and now he's talking about it. Yeah. But now, whatever I'm talking about, when somebody asks me a question, I got some deep real life experience. Like, I have swam through the experience. I know what it smells like. I know what it feels like. I know what it tastes like. And the answers that I can provide to the questions I get are much more actionable. Whereas before, it stayed in the conceptual perspective. And so maybe to the uncommon communicator community, if you can't answer a question deeply on the presentation you've presented, that's an indicator that you've got to live and experience the topic that you're discussing just a little bit more.
Yeah, that's exactly it. And that is really the key to being comfortable, being successful, being a good speaker. And that really goes to a lot of even just general conversation, right? We've all been there with the guy where, you know, you just know that he's just babbling on. And, you know, I do want to touch on one thing that you talked about as well, too, which is really when you know the topic and you're sharing that topic, there's something that is, being open about it. Like one thing that you do, and one thing I struggle with is I sanitize my conversations, you know, and that's something that I just still am working. I mean, it's difficult for me because all of my stories in the past were this guy, this person, this individual, this company, and I've sanitized those. And looking at it through this perspective is, am I just making stories up, you know, to fit my need? And I mean, these are real stories, but I don't have, and I haven't stored those facts in my mind that, you know, on January 7th, we did this with Bill, you know, out on the malt house deck. You know, those are true things that happen. And I think that's an important part of how you tell stories is you use real names, real people, real color. You really paint that picture and it's okay. And you shared this with me and not on this podcast yet, but you talked about how you kind of evolved through that as well too, where you thought, I didn't want to mention the company or get them in trouble. Well, there, and then you did it. And did you, of course, you know, you're always pushing a little bit, aren't you? But did you get in trouble? No. Right. And those things bring true value. And I think that's the other component I know I'm working on. That's something that I'm processing through. What I've decided though is, cause I've stuffed a lot of emotions and feelings and everything away for years, that it's going to have to happen on my new stories, because I don't think I can dig the facts out of some of these older stories. Otherwise I'm just making them up. And then I truly am just making the story to fit the time frame. But Jesse, I've really enjoyed this time meeting and connecting with you again. Your way of telling stories, and especially that you put them into a book, really weaves, you know, who you are. And I think there's a lot of value. I'm going to encourage everybody. We'll have a link in the show notes on how to buy the book, look into it. There's an audio version of it as well. We'll have links to your website. But how else can tell us how else can people get a hold of you?
Man, so obviously the website. The other way, I am hyperactive on LinkedIn. And so in terms of like daily habits, I spend a good amount of time on LinkedIn every day. And so if people want to connect, make a comment, let's connect there and get a feel for what you're really dealing with. Because if you want to work with me, this is what you're going to get. Right. And so maybe I recommend that you get a feel for the flavor that I bring. And you can do that best through interacting on LinkedIn. Obviously on my website, there's links to my email address and all the other socials, all the other good stuff. But you know, James, you and I were talking about this before we started. Let me know you're there, because the one thing that drives me nuts is not like good feedback. I love it. Critical feedback, I love it. No feedback, I hate it. It drives me nuts. And so if you're there, let me know you're there, because it really does mean a lot to me.
Well, we'll definitely provide some information on how to contact you in the show notes. Maybe together we can tie our social media moguling together for this episode so people can learn a little more about Jesse. But I'm going to ask you this, and I'm asking all my guests this now, is what do you think is the UC moment? The uncommon communicator moment says, you know, we've been talking for an hour. What sums up? What do people leave with that they could use from this conversation today?
Oh, man, that's a good one. I'm going to say the one thing that people should take away from this conversation is the value in sharing your story from your perspective with all the dirty details. The value is it's liberating and healing for you as an individual. It gives people hope and gives them permission to do more of the same. I mean, James, you've said it several times. There's a lot of things that you haven't shared for many reasons, and you're not the only one. And so in sharing our story as courageously as you can right now, right, you'll get more courageouser as you get the reps in. But share your perspective with all the dirty details, and it'll help you build deeper connections with the person that's directly in front of you.
I love that. That's a great UC moment. Share your story with all the dirty details. What more do we need than that? We're going to end with that. And that's all we got. See you. Bye.